Hi, welcome back to my channel. My name is Rose, and in this video, I actually need some help with my jewel orchids. If you've been watching my videos for a while now, you may have seen my wishlist video that I put out at the end of 2019, where I shared that I would really like to own a Makota's Petola. Since then, I did get one. You can find the unboxing of that here. Whoa, this is a lot of linking of videos, sorry about that. Anyway, my Makota's Petola died and my Makota's Lowy whatever is struggling a lot. I have them in this little house. One just died really rapidly and this other one just looks very sad. So I figured, why not get some help from an expert, like an actual expert. This is what it currently looks like. They are sitting in a little terrarium with some moss and ferns, with plastic in the front to close it off. But look, this is the Makota's Lowy eye, or whatever is left of it. And then I got this one in the birthday unboxing that I did, but it's also not done well. It's grown this little leaf since June, and it's right now November. So I definitely need some help. Here we go. Tropical palms. I think we made it to the expert. Let's go, little ones. Walking into the big greenhouse. Hey!
Hey! Welcome.
Thank you so much. This is Rogier, the manager of the greenhouses here at the Botanic Gardens in Leiden. Please help me save my jewel orchids.
Let me see. They're not dead yet, but they definitely need some care.
Well, one died off completely and then there's two that are very sad still.
Okay, but there is still hope left. So I can show you what to do with them. I've shown something very cool to show you here. We find these leaves very beautiful because they have these patterns, but do you know why they have these colors?
No idea.
Mostly with plants with patterns like this, when they live on the forest floor, it's pure camouflage. So here, for example, you see a Makota's how it would grow in nature. And if we have one in a pot...
Wait, I don't see it at all. I just see moss.
It's here.
Oh!
So this is why they have these patterns. When we have them in a pot, they are very showy. And people think like, nah, this is not natural. This is so extravagant. But when you see them in the forest, they're actually very hard to find.
That is so cool. Wow, I literally didn't see it.
No, when I was in the jungle, I was always the one that was very interested in terrestrial orchids. Therefore, I always walked very slow. I always was the last one in the row. And all these people, they just stepped almost on top of the jewel orchids. And I kept staring on the floor, and then I saw these jewel orchids where everybody just walked over. So you can only find them when you are looking for them specifically. So this is a very, very nice case. And well, your plants, we really have to give them some care, but I think that with that you will have really big plants within a year, because they're happy, they grow really fast, and that's what we're going to do now.
Okay, let's go.
I thought it's a good idea to have some distraction with some arrows, because this is probably how you lure all the people in.
And then yes, you do.
After they have seen all the aroids, we can focus on the really beautiful plants.
The jewels.
Yeah.
So what actually are jewel orchids?
Well, jewel orchids is a word we use for a group of orchids which are not necessarily related to each other. But as the name says, they have a jewel-like appearance. And this is actually not very new, actually, in the past. For example, in Kalimpong, which is an area in the Himalaya, they used to believe that a long time ago there were fairies and they were playing in the forest. But they forgot that the sun was setting and that they were in the forest while it was dark, and they were not allowed in the forest when it was dark. So they got scared and they ran home. And while they ran home, their clothing was tearing apart in the bushes. And from the pieces of clothing that fell on the ground in the moss, grew these little orchids, aww, which are called the jewel orchids. And that's what they believe in Himalayas for a very long time. At the moment, they become really popular as a houseplant. But even in the Victorian times, they had these little greenhouses like you have here. They loved it, and they put all kinds of plants, including jewel orchids, inside. This is the Lutetia discolor, And this is the most famous one because it's one of the easiest to grow.
Mm.
It's easy because it has this very thick rhizome, as you can see here, and therefore it can stand a little bit lower humidity than most jewel orchids. So this jewel orchid you can grow in your house without any extras. You don't need a greenhouse.
Oh, but mine is in a greenhouse. Is that then bad?
Does it grow very well?
No.
Well, there you go. it's a tough plant, and they
come
can
on,
take
baby.
It. You have the right soil, because many people grow jewel orchids in Swartland, which is an excellent medium. You have a medium of more potting soil,
yeah,
which for these plants is better.
Okay.
But if you keep this one a little bit drier, so actually only water it when the soil starts to dry out, then it's perfect. And
okay,
it will grow into a plant this big eventually. The most beautiful jewel orchids are probably the ones that require a little bit more attention. For example, this is an Anutuchilus. Anutuchilus is actually the group of orchids that I was saying about in the Himalayas.
Ah,
piece of
the fairy ones.
Fairy clothing. And these orchids, because they are thinner, as you can see, is the rhizome of the Anutuchilus is much thinner than that of the Ludicia. So this is why it's more sensitive to drought. So to grow this species, it's best to grow it in a terrarium. I have a lot of these at home that I bought Orchids.nl. It's this nursery in the Netherlands, but I know they're not made by him, so he got them somewhere else. But it's a very simple plastic terrarium with a roof not too strong LED light.
Small light.
Yeah, they grow in quite shady areas. So this is not a plant that you grow in the same spot as you would grow your normal orchids.
Then yeah.
Either one of the two will suffer. And if you grow these jewel orchids and they will turn more yellow, it's usually because you keep them too light.
Okay.
So if you don't have a terrarium with LED light, a very good place to grow them is in some kind of a glass jar on a north-facing window. That's if you are in the northern hemisphere. If you live
yes.
in the southern hemisphere, it should be a south-facing window.
Yeah.
But it's actually a windowsill where you have no direct sunlight, but a lot of blue sky.
Okay.
And that's the perfect light for them.
Okay.
The Anutuchilus is from the same group of orchids as the Ludicia. And another species from this group is this one, which is quite recently in general cultivation. This one is called Asclepias. And it's a South American species, and especially if you put some light on it, you'll get this very nice silver.
Oh, yeah, it's really shiny.
Glitter effect, which is typical for the jewel orchids. And these orchids are quite new in cultivation, but they seem quite easy to grow. So they have the same culture as most other species, especially if you have a container like these, they grow very fast. And then we continue with this group and we get more South American species. Anutuchilus and Ludicia are from Southeast Asia.
Yes.
Aspidogina is from South America. But even in temperate areas, for example in Europe and Northern America and Northern Asia, you have jewel orchids, even growing near to the Arctic Circle.
Oh.
So depending on where your species is from, the temperature you give them is suitable. So for example, the ones in this box are more cool growing species, which you can grow in a house, but if you live in a very hot area, these will not be an easier one.
Okay.
Then probably the Southeast Asian ones are a little bit easier. But we have another Aspidogina species. That's this one.
That looks so different.
Yeah, it doesn't have the glitter effect, but it's still pretty nice.
Yeah.
And then one of my favorites is the Palexia laxa, which makes these big leaves on the stalk, which is almost like a... They have this sort of an arrowy look over them.
Yeah, they're quite big for what you expect for jewel orchids.
Yeah, these orchids, they will look like this and eventually will make a long spike with small green flowers. And then you have these ones. This is Cyclopogon. And these are jewel orchids that often grow also on branches of trees, as long as it's very mossy. They're very easy to grow. They like small pots because, as an epiphyte, they like to be tight with the roots, then they grow best. But if you do that, they grow really nice. These orchids you can also grow in a plastic Ziploc bag.
Ah, yes.
It's not very pretty. I am more a collector than an aesthetic grower. So my house is full of Ziploc bags. That's why I also never invite people to look at my collection, because it literally looks like
plastic
a garbage dump. Yeah.
Yeah.
But if you have this is more aesthetic. So
yeah, this is very pretty.
And then we have one more species from this group that I want to show you, but I'll keep that one for later.
Okay.
First I'm going to show you some other species. For example, this is a Crepidium metallicum, which is from a different group of orchids. They are not closely related to the other jewel orchids, But because they have this very beautiful foliage and they require the same type of cultivation, they are still very popular.
Yeah.
People that collect this, they also like to collect that. So they grow really nicely together. And then there is one group of orchids that is my favorite group of orchids. These are Corybas. They are again from another group of terrestrial orchids. So they are not related to the ones I've shown so far, but they have very beautiful leaves and also very pretty flowers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It looks like a clarinervium almost.
Yeah, it's like a miniature
Anthurium.
Yeah, they have a velvety shine, some have silvery veins, some have pink veins. And for example, this one was one plant last year,
mm-hmm.
So it more or less doubles every year. The cultivation of these plants is a little bit tricky.
So if people have questions about this and they want to grow it, we can make a new video?
Yeah, we can make a new video, but also Corybas are quite rare cultivation still.
Mm-hmm.
I'm afraid that you have an information video of a group of plants that most people cannot buy.
Okay.
But they are very pretty and I hope they will become more available. I have a few species which grow very fast, so I have big hopes that eventually they will become really common plants.
Yeah.
Even Phalaenopsis can have very beautiful patterned leaves. So these are not seen as jewel orchids, but it doesn't mean that they're not beautiful. There are many species of epiphytical orchids. An epiphytical orchid, by the way, for people that don't know, is an orchid that grows in a tree. So they grow on the branches of a tree because on the forest floor there's very little light. There are big ferns and other plants. They're hard to compete with. So if you grow on the branches of a tree, you have this whole kingdom of light and fresh air and pollinators. So many orchids that we grow, they grow on the branches of trees, including these type of orchids like Phalaenopsis. And some of them, they have these patterned leaves.
Yeah.
This is one of these same buckets with Macodes petola.
These I recognize.
Yeah, this is one of the more common species of jewel orchids. I think it's mostly because they were in cultivation a little bit earlier and people started sowing them and multiplying them earlier. So
okay.
It's not necessarily that they are easier, it's just that they just happen to be here. But they are indeed very easy, but they are also very easy to kill. Yeah. The thing with jewel orchids, especially with the more sensitive ones like this, is a stable condition. So that's why if you have a terrarium, it's very good to sort of keep it closed because you don't have to water very often. What these plants really hate is that they dry almost out, that they become a little bit limp.
Yeah.
And then you water them again. This is actually a moment on which they get rot. And when they get rot in the rhizome, it doesn't stop. It continues until your whole plant is rotted. So what you can do is, when you see that happen, is that you take your plant out, you cut all the damaged parts off, and you hope that you can make cuttings of the healthy parts.
I try to do that with
Yeah, but if that's too small, too much of the tip, so the higher you take it, the less likely it will grow, then there's a big chance it will die. But if you keep them very stable, in a container like this, if it's closed, I water these, I think, maybe once a month, twice a month. Because these are quite open, because they have this metal cover.
Yeah.
But if it's like fully closed, for example, this terrarium, your little glass house, you can close fully,
mm-hmm.
and then you can probably water it once every 2 months or something like
okay.
that. And that's usually perfect. So they don't like it really wet, and they don't like it really dry, they like it in the middle. So when you manage to grow them, you will see, I put, I think, 3 cuttings in this box, and they explode.
They're so big.
So here I have this big jar of Macodes. I will take a few out. They are very, very
wow.
easy to just tear apart. So don't worry.
It's just a big clump.
It's just one big clump. What I'm going to get first is, for example, this plant. This is going to flower. I need to make some pictures of the flower, so this one I will leave alone. But I noticed there is another one that's going to flower here. So normally when you see these flower spikes, it's very tempting to leave them here because it's interesting to see the flowers. But I can tell you with Macodes, the flowers are not really worth it. They are pretty boring. So of course, when you get them in flower for the first time, let them grow so that you can see what the flowers look like. With Anuktochilis, for example, the flowers are usually very pretty. You can leave them on them. Aspidogynes, some are pretty, some are pretty boring. But with Macodes, in generally, they are very small, boring, twisted flowers. So what I always do when they start to flower, I take the flower spike off. Because as soon as you do that, this plant will think like, my flower spike is gone, what to do now? It will make side shoots quicker. So when you don't do that, it will first flower and then afterwards it will make side shoots and this delays the plant. If you do it like that, it will make side shoots quicker.
Okay.
So here we have a shoot on which I remove the flower spike.
Ah, yes.
And you see that here is already a flower spike coming.
Yeah.
So what I often do with these plants is that I
break them here, or I cut them, but they are very, juicy, so they are easy to break. Here you have the bottom side of the plant, which will resprout. It will make shoots. I've done that before here with this one. Here, and you see I've done this, and here it's starting to resprout again. But the tip, you can make a cutting of. So what I always do, I let them dry out for one day, that the wound can heal. But after a day, I remove this lowest leaf, and then I plant them in a little pot of sphagnum.
So,
yeah.
Okay.
Because they are not pretty yet, I just put them in a plastic box like this. This is a box of bird food. So what you see, what happens here, is that they recover pretty well. They make lots of roots. You can see here the fuzzy roots are already forming.
Yeah.
And also they make this new shoot. And if you're lucky, they make multiple new shoots and you will get very pretty clumpy plants. And this is a very easy way to start with just one or just a few of these Makotas and end up with like
a million.
So you can have one for in your terrarium.
Yeah.
You can try it. I'll give you one of the settled ones because you don't have to wait. It will start.
So I don't ruin it.
You just put it here.
Yeah, it can pop in there because the other one doesn't live in there
apparently. No, you have a free space. Well, look at that.
So can you tell me what's wrong with the little loei that's in there? Or loei?
Let's see.
You can pull it out because it's in
there. Yeah, let's pull it out. Well, the substrate is good. It will suffer from the Selaginella though. You have to be careful because these Selaginellas are very aggressive.
Yeah.
But basically, it's now recovering very well because look at here. Look here.
It's growing!
It's making two new shoots.
I didn't kill it.
You didn't kill it, and it will recover. And if it does, because now did you had it open before?
I used to have it open, but I closed it a few months ago.
Well, you see that it's really enjoying the fact that you closed it, that the humidity is getting much higher. And eventually these two shoots will become really pretty. What I would do is then remove these old damaged leaves and you will have two very pretty growing leaves.
It's living. Yeah. I thought it was like dying. So.
What is important if you have these type of conditions is that it looks very pretty, but you have to keep in mind that at least once a year you have to break the whole thing apart.
Okay.
Because this moss will break down, and when it starts to break down, you will get more bacteria. If you have fresh sphagnum, it has a sort of disinfectant effect.
Yeah.
And that works really well with these orchids. And if you wait too long, you can cause some rotting.
Okay.
So that's why if you take it out every year, but it's the same with the Selaginella. If you leave it there, that one will not rot, but it will just fill your greenhouse until the
okay.
So that's a little bit dangerous to keep it there.
I need a bigger greenhouse for the Selaginella.
Yeah. So if you don't want to do that with your whole greenhouse, what I would suggest is plant this one in a small pot,
mm-hmm.
so that you can just take the pot out
and
put the pot back in.
Yeah, that sounds better.
And that's maybe better. You also need less moss. If you have a lot of them together, then it's just one big pot.
Yeah.
But if you just have a few small plants, then it's maybe better to use pots. Then because sphagnum is expensive, so why waste it? But it's actually
pretty though. Look at how big that thing is.
They are doing better than you thought.
Yeah.
This year, this greenhouse will be full of Makotas. There will be no space for your Selaginella. So
that's okay. Yeah. I will make another space. I will buy more.
And then you can grow all these species. I also started with a few. Well, I grow these jewel orchids for a long time. But as you know, with plants, sometimes you have these waves that you get a little bit less interest in the plant, and then you lose, especially these plants, you lose them. So that's why it's important to give them away, because if you lose interest in them and they die, and after a few years you think like, they were actually pretty nice, I want to grow them again, it's good if you give them away to friends because you can get them back.
Yes, so that's smart.
That's why I love giving these things away. Maybe in a few years I will get bored with them again, and then not with Cordybas though. Cordybas will always be my my little friend.
Aww.
So yeah, no.
Love forever.
Yeah.
But then I will have a lot of them so I can give them back to you when you want to.
Exactly, yeah.
Cool.
Actually, the little Ludicia, so I'm gonna keep that outside and make a little pot for it. I guess I can just keep it like this.
Like this on the shady spot.
Okay, I can do that. Thank you so much for rescuing and for actually the beautiful Makotas petiola as well. That is awesome. If you guys enjoyed this video with Rogier, please let us know in the comments. He's the most knowledgeable plant person that I personally know.
Do you know so few people?
I don't know many people. No, stop it. We can make more videos if you want. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up. Do the thumbs up.
Yeah.
And subscribe to my channel if you haven't already for all the planty knowledge. And also let us know in the comments what plant you would like to know more about. Because I'm no expert, but I might have access to experts. Thank you so much for talking with us.
No problem.
And we will see you in the next video. Bye.
See you again.